First of all, truly honored to have the man who brought the real-time payment to this country at this scale on our stage, unveiling Paytm POS machine. So a big cheer for our dear mentor and I would say guide and the champion of payments in India, Nandan. Really, personally, I'm very thankful for that.
Thank you, Vijay.
Nandan, I have some question answers and some conversation on stage. So first of all, you saw a little bit of what we were talking about today.
Yeah.
So while they're building it up this on the stage, talk about something that you saw today and if it is useful according to you in your vision that you saw long back and tens of years back, I would say, and how it fits or what kind of things we should be doing.
No, absolutely. I think absolutely what you're doing is with the vision we had, which is democratizing payments, making sure that everyone in every nook and corner of this country has access to digital payments. And nobody has done a better job of that than you, Vijay. So you have been a pioneer in this field, and I'm grateful for your contribution. I think the all-in-one POS is a very important device. I think we do have choices that people have. They can use cards, UPI, wallets. And you're saying that's not material. I'll just give you one device and any payment type you take. So I think that really eliminates this A versus B kind of argument, because everything is in one device. So I think it's a brilliant idea. And I think our goal should be merchant payments, which is what you're doing, because I think it's more than P2P, it's P2M, and not online, but offline.
Absolutely.
If, you know, 20, 30, 40 million small merchants in this country can accept payments easily, which you are doing, I think that's the future, and I'm glad that you're doing this.
Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, Nandan again, and I will have a few question answers and discussion on that with Nandan. Nandan has agreed to spend 1 hour with us, so I'll try
one hour, starting 11 o'clock.
So. So I will try to make most of it. So like you said, Nandan, that the vision is about how to enable these large number of not just online but offline merchants. Online merchants inevitably are going to add payments. So there is no nudge or push required, if you will. They themselves are very active, persuasive of payments. Tell me one thing, that what do you see offline payments taking shapes of? For example, like we saw a casual P2P payment becoming a QR-led payment, and then QR-led payment becoming, now we're taking the next stage, that IoT-led payments, like you saw today.
Yeah.
So what do you think, and what will be the anchor reason and kind of solutions that will drive the scale that we are envisaging, 20, 30, 40 million SMEs?
No, I think you're absolutely on the right track. Obviously, QR payments will be huge, and I think India is a country where we are doing huge amount of experimentation with QR codes. I think all-in-one QR, Bharat QR, UPI QR, all these are different forms of interoperable QR codes. So I think in that sense, India is a leader in interoperable QR codes.
Absolutely.
Like if you go in China, there'll be an Alipay QR code, there'll be a WeChat QR code. But this Indian concept that this QR code, I can use some other app, I think that's the greatness of what, and you played a big role in that.
Yeah.
So that's clearly there. The second thing is that, in fact, you made a reference to FASTag. I had actually done the design of FASTag. I know they know this.
Yes, I know that. By the way, 10 years back. The very reason that I quoted FASTag was because I personally also see FASTag as a next level of payments.
That's right.
And
so this is,
instead of person, a machine is paying.
Exactly. And when we designed the FASTag, and I had a committee in 2010 which came out of the design using RFID tags, we said this is not only for highway, we said this is a platform. Once every vehicle, whether it's a car or a bus or a truck, has a RFID tag attached to a payment instrument, we have a platform. And the same platform can be used for parking charges, which you already started.
Yes.
Congestion charges, you can say that tomorrow vehicles coming into Connaught Place or Fort pay higher. So I think there are lots of innovations, and I think you can lead on that. So I think I'm very happy to see the parking charge with RFID tag.
Thank you.
That's very good.
And Nandan, I want to very honestly acknowledge the fact that when we discussed the possibilities on FASTag, internally the team looked at it as a leapfrog of the payments where the human is paying with a phone to a device is paying with its own tag.
Exactly.
And maybe we are not understanding in a common
world. It's a machine-to-machine payment system.
It's a machine-to-machine payment. We are not able to comprehensively understand what it is. So that is why you would have seen that Paytm now being the last bank to launch, Paytm Bank is the largest issuer of QR codes or FASTag codes now out there in the market.
And I think the other thing, I think also the largest user of Aadhaar eKYC.
Oh yes, absolutely. I mean, that's
your acceleration of account opening with Aadhaar eKYC is also the highest.
Absolutely. I mean, to be honest about it, I mean, it is a small statement to make, but what you built tens of years back, what you envisaged.
Tens of years, yeah, last 10 years.
Last tens of years, meaning you must have thought about it 10 years back and then got it done. We are the person who are the biggest beneficiary, if you will, of that has been created. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
To everyone who was in UIDAI, to FastTech creation team, to UPI creation teams, these are incredible world-grade solutions.
Thank you. So I had a couple of, since we are here and I have your attention, two, three product ideas for you. You're a great product guy. First is in your all-in-one POS, you should also have Aadhaar-enabled payments.
We are building that.
You're building it?
Okay. Satish ji is our CEO of Payment Bank.
I know Satish
and
ji.
I want to tell you, you will hear a cool sort of deployment from us on AEPS.
Yeah, because AEPS is actually a silent success. Does 100 million Indians today use AEPS to withdraw money in some village? And
so
if you can,
the devices have been created with a biometric scanner, printer, because we took it a long haul call. Yeah. So
AEPS will further add to your all-in-one proposition.
Family.
So that's one. Second thing is, do something about feature phones. Because I think we will for a long time to have feature phones. And we already have a UPI on feature phone. But nobody has taken that feature and made something with it.
Okay.
So I want you to apply your brilliant product mind to that.
Thank you. Very kind of you to say brilliant product mind. But I take that as a challenge. And hopefully coming back to Bangalore in a quarter or two with a feature phone.
Great. I'll come for that launch also.
Beautiful. Okay.
The thing is, we have to have one solution for smartphones, which you have already.
Correct.
We have to have one feature for feature phones, which you will come out with in a few months. And we have to have one solution for people who don't have phones,
Aadhaar feature smart.
Billion
three
people
stacks
are covered. Yeah. So that's the vision that we had. So I'm sure you will be able to deliver on
Beautiful. That. Thank you so much for that. Tell me one more thing. When you had envisaged real-time money transfer, which is now talk of the town in the world rooms. I mean, I sit in front of people in Japan or Canada and regulators, and they all want to know, how was your country able to deploy real-time deductions? And US will build it in 2023 onwards.
Yeah,
I mean, it is not even coming that in next three, four years, we will see that they're building
it. Fed now is supposed to be 2024.
Yeah, so 5 years forward, US will have it, what we have had 5 years back. Now, and brilliant execution of everybody together here, literally 1 lakh crores of payments and billion payments. How do you see UPI going where, what kind of use cases, what kind of solutions and things that will solve? And your commentary on what you saw UPI doing till today?
No, I think the way that you and others have used UPI is spectacular, and I'm very pleased with that. 1.3 billion payments last month. I think the important thing is to don't think of UPI as a product. Think of it as a protocol.
Yeah.
It's really whether you use UPI with phone, card, feature phone, no, it's basically a protocol.
Correct.
It's a protocol with what we call as a payment markup language, a way to describe payments.
Okay.
So for the first time in the world, payment is now software. We can describe a payment saying, you know, everything can be put as
API call on UPI.
So it's a payment language. So I think that's one thing, and therefore the possibilities are much more. And it's the only payment system which you can use P2P, P2M, offline, online, this, that, RFID tag, recharge your fast tag, all that. So I think thinking of it that way is important. I think the recent thing that you can now have recurring mandate on UPI, which I hope you're going to use soon.
Correct.
Especially for when you launch your SIPs and all that, automatically every day 10 rupees into my SIP account. So that's a huge feature that you should think about.
We are actually the first launcher of that.
Yeah.
So
okay.
You will
so you're on.
Not just. I think UPI is India's pride of what payments should the world know India for, and with the kind of features that we've been able to launch on that, we are clear about it that this is what is, like you said, you leapfrogged it as a payment as a software. I leapfrogged it as a. There is no one use case that we cannot think of.
Yeah. So and now the sky's the limit. Now I think. And, you know, if you've seen Dilip Pasbe's statements, he wants to go from 1 billion a month to 1 billion a day. So I think with your support, that'll happen.
Thank you. And what do you think of the commercial model? This is a little bit of discussion some days back was happening when government said merchants should not pay a fee. Mm-hmm. So how this is going to, I would say, explode the number of merchant base, and then industries have been challenging that what business model will be. So what is your point of view on
that? Well, I think... The thing is that if you look around, if you see, in fact, also I've been talking about it the last several years, your MDR is going to trend towards zero. Even if government did not get involved, MDR is going to go towards zero. And you have done that. So it's
I publicly say that MDR business, payment business model were to be built and in our business model on day one, MDR tends towards zero.
Yeah.
We did expect that it will reach towards near zero, if not zero, and then Eureka moment of zero has happened.
And therefore, the question comes then, how do you make money, right? And I think the money will come from all the other services that you have. And I think there's another big important, see, we talked about Aadhaar, FASTag, UPI. There's another huge innovation which is coming, which is the account aggregator network. And I hope you're paying serious attention to that. Because we'll be the first country in the world where individuals will be empowered to use their own data. Now, once we do that, that means that merchant of yours who's taking digital payments can then use the digital footprints of the payment record to get credit from your bank or somebody else. And that becomes the app that makes him come to digital payment because now he has a digital footprint that he can monetize the loan.
Yes.
So I think that is where the money will be made. And I hope you're going to do that.
I think we have clearly, Nandan, in the direction that you talked about, Paytm's mission statement says bringing 500 million Indians to the mainstream of economy. Yeah. It does not say solving payment for 500 million Indians or bank account for 500 million. The advantage of economy can only come if the growth capital can be extended and the wealth solution can be given and the protection can be extended. So I fundamentally do not believe that payment is the beginning or the end. Payment is actually the beginning with the features like account aggregation, with the features like creating data rich customers, we will see incredible amount of lending.
So I think if you can get all your millions of consumers and millions of small businesses to get access to flow-based credit in real time, paperless, cashless, boom, we're done.
I just cannot see that how people say that Paytm does not have a business model versus Paytm has a business model. You literally have quoted our business model in public right now.
Okay, great. Wow, thanks.
So tell me one more thing. I mean, this is a little more over the bigger arc question because I'm working behind the scene on this lending question. And then I see the cost of capital that is extended to these people, sort of a next level of solution that we need. You know, it's like next solution we need. And it is not a problem in a big way because they can afford large credit, but delinquencies increase if you pay or distribute with a higher fee. So you want to reduce. And like you've been the champion, that remove the hindrances, take them towards tend towards zero. What do you think of India's access to capital to lend for SMEs? How would the rate of that, the interest cost, and I'm talking about source capital cost, not the sell capital cost to the SME, reducing. What are your understanding, especially seeing the NBFC environment and banks being restrictive and whatnot?
No, I think we should not get distracted by the current challenges that are there. Obviously, we have an issue with bank NPAs, NBFC NPAs, housing loans, all that stuff. But out of this will emerge the next generation of credit, which is going to be entirely tech-based, entirely data-based, will be flow-based and not asset-based.
Okay.
It's not loans against your assets.
Okay.
It's loans against the flow of your business.
Got it.
And that is actually good for newcomers because I may not have assets, but if I can show flow, I get credit. It'll all be using all this new technology we have. It'll also be AI-based.
Yeah.
So what will happen is once you have consumers have, or small businesses have a data footprint, then AI will help you to decide whether he can be given a loan or not. So you'll be able to take a loan credit decision in few seconds using AI, which I'm sure you're heading towards that. So I think we're entering a whole new, just like digital payments has nothing to do with cash payments, the new type of credit is nothing to do with the old type of credit.
Oh, that's a beautiful line.
Yeah.
The new kind of credit has nothing to do with the old kind of credit where you traditionally underwritten with a human intelligence or mistakes or
and using asset
influences
based,
and bias
paper-based,
or asset-based created.
Takes weeks, all that stuff.
And the new age. So in other words, if I may say, extending this, you believe fundamentally that new age technology, data, AI-led loans, which will be far more spread out, will have much less NPAs, if you will.
Oh, yeah, because one is that it's data-based. Second, you're going to apply AI. You'll use AI to figure out who's a good credit risk. You'll use AI to figure out who's a bad credit risk. You'll be able to handle both sides. And what this means is that pricing will become individual now. In the sense,
instead of a generic,
it's not a one-size-fits-all.
It'll be somebody will pay premium.
Everybody will have a price on risk will be priced on an individual basis, which I think, again, which I'm sure you're planning
right.
that.
That's right.
I'm sorry, I'm not...
No,
not,
I love it. I mean, I'm loving it that my team sitting in this room will have super confidence in business model that we pursue because we say these things and this is what is expected.
Sure.
So you sort of singing my words in your words.
Thank you. And also then, one is the individualization of pricing risks, but the other thing is, in general, credit spread range in the country will come down. See, today what has happened is, the big guys get cheap credit.
Correct.
The small people get expensive credit, money lender, informal. Correct. All that will go away and everything will converge to a band.
Got it.
And you'll make money in that band.
Got it. Beautiful. Now that brings me to the next question of, in fact, it generates two questions because you use the word bank and data and AI. There have been all the talks around the data should be kept protected within this country and a lot of other countries feel uncomfortable by it. So your opinion on that, that what is your opinion and why and what not? And second would be the banks, which we will extend that how payment bank, SFB, etc. So first the data thing.
Yeah, so I think, I to me, the where the data is kept is not the real issue. The real issue is, do you have an architecture which allows borrowers to use their data to get a benefit?
Okay.
And therefore, empowerment of data, to have an architecture where I can access my data, that is the heart of it. And that's what we have, account aggregator, all that. I, as a borrower, can say, get my GST data from GST, get my bank statement, give it to you to take a lending decision. You apply AI, give me a loan. Yeah. All in real time. That is really what I care about.
So what you're saying is, whether it exists with account aggregator, whether it exists...
Account aggregator doesn't have any data.
Actually, he's an He's only a real-time query
like
operator.
A traffic guy.
Traffic guy.
He says, I tell my account aggregator, get my GST data from here, get my income tax data from here, get my bank
data. Interface for...
It's a real-time system.
System. My question was more around these kind of debates that were being done that India should... I mean, I met a couple of people from United States, and they were very concerned that why is India so concerned about this data protection being in this domicile watered, and does India have some use case, or does India does not have use case? So my point was that I think we are a mature economy at a scale, and I believe this after a particular point in time, why should we go out and so on? So do you have any...
As I said, to me the real issue is wherever the data is stored.
It's accessible to
Is it accessible to the borrower in real time.
In real time. So that the decision can be made. Now let's go to the banks.
Sure.
You saw payment banks, SFB banks, and we're very proud of being a payment bank, actually. And not just the business that we do with it, it's a very profitable and seeing forward. We can actually say this, that if it had credit, we would have not been able to be successful like what we've been here today. We would have been distracted to do something else.
Yeah.
So I actually, in a hindsight, can also say, it is better that we started our journey with payment bank because there is so much to learn, compliance and systems. So talk about how government has converted people on payment bank as an opportunity to, or regulator has given opportunity to convert SFB.
Yeah.
And then there is an on-tap license. And then my friend Sachin Mansal is applying for bank license. So talk about how the financial services ecosystem, fintech as you call, which started from payments and is finally going towards credit, is it going towards full service bank then? And how the neo banks fit into this?
Sure.
So my intention is to learn your understanding of trend and comment on that.
No, I think this is a very important and strategic point. The fact of the matter is, in spite of, there's a whole NPA problem, all that is true, but India as a society, the people are not getting access to credit, especially the small people, the consumers, the small business, SMEs don't get access to credit. And therefore, we need to actually increase the number of players in the market who use technology to deliver credit in a completely different way.
Yeah.
So I think my view is that we need a lot more banks, but they should all be tech-savvy digital banks, not the old stuff, paper, call-up, all that, none of that. So it has to be the way we talked about it. And I think RBI has done an excellent thing by encouraging successful payment banks to become small finance banks by having universal banking on tap, which is, I think, what Sachin is applying for, and also encouraging successful cooperative banks to become small finance banks, and I know that a couple of them are applying. So I think it doesn't matter where it comes from, but I think more of those are required. But any of those guys must use the new architecture.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it won't work.
Yeah.
And that's why I agree with you. I think the fact that you began as a payment bank, you focused on getting that right, getting the transactional efficiency and all that. Now, when you apply and become a small finance bank, you now have a platform for credit at scale.
Yeah, actually, somewhere. So interestingly, we talk about that Indian startups. I'll now take it to a little more generic because you seem to be in a comfortable mood and this conversation is quite something that I envisage as if it can happen ever. So startups, we saw Flipkart exiting and incredible wealth creation. There were many naysayers and still incredible amount of success out there. And then there are next crop of young startups which are not just if we take a milestone of $1 billion, then crossing that. If you take a milestone of something else, then becoming that relevant also. What do you think startup space in India is doing? Good, bad, ugly, correct, right, wrong, anything to be adjusted to? What is your opinion on that?
No, I think I've also written about this recently. I think, first of all, what all you guys have done is phenomenal. Yourself, Sachin and Binny at Flipkart, or Bhavish at Ola. They're all brilliant entrepreneurs, great ambition, great strategy, great execution. So I'm very impressed.
Thank you.
Having said that, I think ultimately it is about making money. And I think it's very, very important because you can certainly grow because there'll be capital, guys will fund you and all that. But ultimately, if you have to be in charge of your destiny, then you have to become profitable, make profits, generate free cash, all that. So I think that flip is what is required. When you go back and look at the history of the great internet companies, Google, Facebook, Amazon, all these guys, they manage that. Yep. So some manage it through advertising, some manage it through e-commerce, and AWS, whatever. But the fact is that after a few years of making losses, which were funded by their VCs,
yep,
they flipped into becoming profitable. So I think my earnest request to all of you guys is get to the path of profitability fast.
For sure. Incredible. In fact, I can speak on behalf of entrepreneurs at whom you named, and I was also asking in one conversation when Sachin was staying on stage that how much losses are good enough losses, and where is the border? And then the FOMO of that, if you address profitability over market share, am I losing market share? Is it okay for that over the profitability? So any comments to young entrepreneurs now who are in early days, and let's say early days of investments where there is an obligation of investment in market share or market learning build-up, how should they build the journey? Less than 100 million funded companies.
Well, I think, you know, in that argument, there is actually another implicit argument. We remember that. What people are saying is that let us use capital to get market share.
Yeah.
So he with the most capital wins. Hmm. And you ultimately reach a point where it becomes you become a winner take all. And once you're a winner take all, then you can decide your prices. And that's the broad argument of this. But it's not necessarily clear that these are winner take all markets.
Yeah.
So if you don't have winner take all markets, then it may be a fool's errand. You keep on spending,
yeah,
but you don't get market dominance.
Yeah.
So I think that's the question.
Yeah, very good. In fact, because I have you here, so I would open some people to ask these questions. And I have this mic in the center. Anybody who's a journalist or a teammate can come and ask these questions. Please ask this. And I would like to wrap up with a few more questions on the stage, if you will. If you were, as an IT service person, built this behemoth in Infosys, incredible institutional organization in your 80s, your 80s meaning 80s of this country time. I wish you create a company in 80s that is as impactful and even more further, by the way. So, because you started in those days and you saw India's market changing, evolving, what is the primary reason India's technology and startup ecosystem is so vibrant? What is in a larger arc that you see changed in this country?
Well, I think a number of things. One is clearly, I think India has come of age. Indian consumers and businesses are much more tech savvy and they're ready for the kind of innovation that you have brought in. So that's clearly the markets, Indian market has come of age, which is not true perhaps in the 80s and so on. So that's point number one. Point number two, I think, is the global recognition of India's potential as a huge market and the fact that global capital is willing to come and support that, and you represent one of the, you know, beneficiaries of that model.
Yeah.
The third thing, frankly, is the India's investment in public infrastructure.
Hmm.
That is, in the digital world, that is, Aadhaar, UPI, Account Aggregator, RFID tag, GSTN.
Hmm.
These are all public infrastructure, but designed in a way that they are designed for private innovators to take advantage of.
Hmm.
So EKYC has an API, UPI has an API, GSTN has an API, RFID tag has an API. The API is deliberate. The idea is that government creates the platforms and innovators like you take advantage of those platforms. So that's been a big part of the journey. Then of course the telecom revolution, initially with Airtel, Idea, Vodafone, and then now with Jio, I think, which has dramatically provided telecom access very cheaply. So I think all these things have come together. And so I think the future is very bright.
Future is very bright. Very beautifully said. So ladies and gentlemen, I am done with my questions. Unless you have any questions, otherwise Nandan will have to go. So I would ask one last question and then, okay, you can come on the mic and then ask this question.
Hi Nandan, this is Amit from Days Info. Hi Vijay.
Hi.
So I just want to understand, like, we have got more than almost like 10 plus unicorns in India, and we have been hearing this story. Even Flipkart was there for me. They were keep on talking about 2016, about IPO, going to IPO. I'm hearing also from you from last few years now about your roadmap to 2021-24 IPO. But still, we have not seen anything which is very concrete in terms of any unicorn going very close to the IPO where we can really see or say, yes, that particular startup is ready for an IPO. What is your take on that?
Well, I think the lesson that we have learned from the IPOs in the US, IPOs or attempts to do IPOs, Uber, WeWork, all that, is that public markets are very much focused on what is your path to profitability. If you are profitable, when you will be profitable, what is that in your business model that will ensure profit? So I think part of the thing is, even in India, where if these unicorns have to approach public markets, they should have very strong answers for that. So I think that's probably one of the reasons perhaps it's taking longer, but it's a matter of time.
In fact, on that note, it is said that Indian stock markets do not value a high growth to a level as much they value free cash flow. I mean, these are two different metrics of the same different stages. Do you believe Indian markets are good for such high-end companies, such companies who have had huge losses in the past and may not be huge free cash generating in future, in short term? Or do you think that they will inevitably go in an international market?
No, I think if they are able to demonstrate, forget what happened in the past, losses, all that is fine.
Yeah, sure.
But if they're able to demonstrate a clear path to profitability, then it's good enough.
Oh, that's good enough. Thank you. Yeah.
Hey, Vijay, hi. Great to see that bus ticketing thing there, you know, in the slides. So you mentioned about India being a data-rich country and a lot of companies looking to leverage that data. Do you feel that, do you believe in future we may see a lot of data-centric NPAs, just like we have bank NPAs?
Chances are less, but I believe that the data will create much faster notification and alerts. How do you solve the collection problem? Actually, the intention collection problem, not that I want you to answer every problem of the business model on the stage, but this is also considered when we build data-led models where the NPAs may not be driven by the bad data decision, but by the bad intention decision.
Yeah. See, one thing is that in the this model of new lending architecture, it is based on working capital, not on assets. The thing is, the moment you have an asset-based model, number of things happen. Number one, you need to have assets in the first place. So it tends to favor incumbents and not challengers. Second, assets can be diverted. You know, there are lots of issues with asset-based lending. What we're talking about is flow-based lending. That means they look at your digital payment history, look at your invoice history, look at your GST history. And that is real stuff. That is real business thing. So it's a far more reliable source of, company's performance. Second is that AI will help us to figure out fraud or somebody wanting to do something wrong. And third is that if you don't have a record of good repayment of loans, that also goes into your digital record.
Yeah.
So your next loan will become difficult. So if you are a serious entrepreneur who wants to build a credit history, I will keep it clean.
We will come and just disrupt this industry. I think right now we are at a stage that connectivity is there all over. But now software is trying to play a catch-up game. So what is your thought on that right now? Like, what is the thing that we are missing? This is the first question. And the second question specifically about GST is that, while GST is a product where, you want smaller merchants to go and fill in those GST and do the compliance, but most of the solutions today in the market today are very desktop or web-based solutions. So why is someone not able to figure out that gap?
Okay.
Well, I mean, that you can figure it out. Why are you asking me? I mean, somebody should figure it out because there's a network. Again, GST is also innovation-led, right? You can have a number of GSPs And anybody can offer a product. So it's up to innovators to come up with better products on the phone, all that, to do GST. So I think it's an opportunity for everyone. On the first question, I think, see, we have had massive changes, right? We have, all of you have come in, innovation is happening. GST has come, Aadhaar has come, UPI has come, account aggregator has come. And things are happening very dynamically. So software often takes time to catch up. But I think now all the pieces of the puzzle are in place. Now it's really about execution and coming out with great innovations and delivering them to a billion people.
And just to add, when do we see, you know, Nandan Nilekani be named formally as a chief technology officer of this country?
No. I'm not looking for any more titles or jobs. I'm fine.
Thank you.
This is the question that me and him were discussing. Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, Nandan, as always, incredible to hear. Thank you.
All the best, Vijay. All the best.
Thank you.